Now we have the third session by Dr. Shubhranshu Mohanty. Sir is going to talk on management of target joint role of chemical and radionuclide synovectomy. Sir is the president Indian Arthroscopy Association and is education chair Indian Society of Hip and Knee Surgeons and president Bombay Orthopedic Society and is professor and head of the unit of KM Hospital Orthopedic Department. He's a consultant orthopedics and the joint replacement surgeon, Jaslok Hospital, Shushruta Hospital and Anavati Hospital, Mumbai. And he's published 52 original scientific research papers in peer-reviewed journals, out of which 11 papers are related to hemophilia. Thank you, sir, for accepting. And sir, actually, I request you to stick to the time, sir.
Thank you. Let me share my screen. First of all, good afternoon to all of you, and thank you for inviting me for this session. Let us, wish each other on this World Hemophilia Day of 2021. And as already Professor Farah told you, that adapting to change, sustaining the care in a new world. Now, there are a lot of questions related to the joints, because 80% of hemophiliac, they bleed into the joint, and 30% they bleed into a muscle. That is why the role of orthopedic surgeons and the therapist comes into picture. Now, the word synoviurthesis is the word which is described. This is the process of injecting into a joint, either by a chemical or a radionuclide material. The chemicals being, rifampicin or, oxytetracycline, and radionuclide materials, I'll discuss it in my lecture. Friends, this is a normal joint. This is the bone is coated over. There is a cartilage and there is a joint lining, which is known as synovial membrane. This synovial membrane, it secretes a fluid or liquid which lubricates the joint. This membrane is the lining of the joint. Now, when this membrane gets inflamed, especially it happens in hemophilia and many other arthritis, so blood supply to this membrane gets increased, and that becomes very vascular. And whenever you move the joint, this membrane that, gets crossed between two bony ends, and that bleeds, and hence there is a hemarthrosis in a hemophilia. When there's a recurrent bleeding, that eats away this cartilage, and when the cartilage is destroyed, the bone gets exposed and it becomes very painful. That is why we know it is arthritis. Professor Judy has shown you this vicious circle. I am just going to explain you in a nutshell that whenever there is a bleeding into the joint, it is known as acute hemarthrosis, and that leads to a blood accumulation in the joint, what is known as diffuse hematoma. This blood accumulation leads to an initiation of an inflammatory response inside the joint. So that joint lining or synovium gets inflamed, blood supply gets increased. So there is proliferation of blood vessels, or blood supply gets increased. And because of proliferation of blood vessels, there is again a recurrent or repeated bleeding into the joint, or recurrent hemarthrosis. There is a particle in the blood known as hemosiderin, and it's a chemical which gets deposited in this joint lining or synovium, and that induces or that irritates the lining again. And because of this irritation, the joint lining becomes thicker and thicker, what is known as synovial hypertrophy, or the joint lining becomes very thick and joint becomes swollen. And when the joint lining becomes thicker, that again gets crossed between two bony ends, and again the bleeding occurs. So that is a vicious circle which goes inside the joint of a PWH. So one needs to break this vicious circle. But it is not only the end. They release an enzyme into the joint, what is known as metalloproteinase, which is very detrimental for the cartilage. It causes erosion of the cartilage, as I saw it in my earlier picture. So that destroys the cartilage. And because of inflammatory response, there is muscle spasm. And when there is muscle spasm, there is gradual weakness of the muscle, what is known as muscle atrophy. So destruction of the cartilage along with the muscle spasm leads to a condition, what is known as hemophilic arthropathy, a point of no return. So in order to prevent this hemophilic arthropathy, we have to break this vicious circle at this stage, that is the synovial hypertrophy stage. Hence, to prevent a chemical hemophilic arthropathy, you have to treat at the stage of the chronic synovitis. That is the crux of the treatment. Now, how will you treat? You have to take out the joint lining. How will you take out? So we do a conventional synovectomy way back, you know, 40 years back, they used to do, you know, they have to interrupt doing a surgery and taking out the joint lining known as conventional synovectomy, but it requires a lot of factor. Joint becomes stiff after the surgery. It requires a long period of rehabilitation. So people tried with a arthroscopic synovectomy, putting an endoscope inside the joint. But it was not helping much because, you know, though you take out about 80-90% of the joint lining, still you tend to leave around 10% of the, you know, lining behind, especially in the posterior aspect of the joint, and that leads to again recurrence of this, you know, synovitis. So of late people have tried the radioactive material as well as the chemicals. So these are the two things which are being done now all over the world. Now, hence the term is synovectasis or chemical synovectomy. Initially, people tried with steroids and injecting steroid into the joint, though it was initially effective, but there was no long-lasting efficacy. Then people tried with osmic acid. The injection itself was very painful, and also it caused the cartilage damage. But rifampicin and oxytetracycline has been very effective. The effect has been very long-lasting. Hence, these two has been used as a, you know, material for chemical synovectomy. Why rifampicin or oxytetracycline? Because it has got a property of proteolysis and antifibrinolysis. In that case, it causes synovial sclerosis or fibrosis of the synovium, and hence further episodes of the bleeding is prevented. So the advantage is that antihemophilic factor coverage is much less. You give around 20%, you know, correction. There is no drawbacks of surgery. It's a very simple procedure, can be done by anybody in the OPD procedure. And it's cost effective because the injection is not very expensive. One injection of rifampicin costs around, you know, 400, 500 rupees. And one injection of oxytetracycline costs hardly 20 rupees. But the problem is the availability. Rifampicin injection has not been approved by Drug Controller General of India. And hence, it is not available in our country, though tablets are available. And oxytetracycline, it is mostly it is by used by veterinary surgeons. That way, it is you know, not available much nowadays. Now, initially in 1980s, people tried in rheumatoid arthritis, but results were poor. But in hemophilic arthritis or hemophilic synovitis, these two injections has been very effective, and the effect has been 70 to 86% or 95% in the literature. But there was no objective assessment to show that whether this injection is really acting. Just patients were telling that there is no further episode of bleeding or it is getting controlled. So we did a, you know, objective control trial, and we have been successful to show that it is really acting on the joint. So basically, hemophilic joint is divided into four grades. First grade is a transient synovitis with no post-traumatic sequelae. That means the patient or PWH has got a bleeding, and there are more than three episodes of bleeding in 6 months period. But after the bleeding, then it completely subsides and joint becomes normal. Grade two is permanent synovitis. Though bleeding occurs and bleeding becomes unlight, pain goes away, but still the joint swelling persists. That is grade two or permanent synovitis. Grade three is chronic arthropathy with axial deformity and muscle atrophy. That means it is associated with some kind of deformity, like a, you know, joint is bent in axial direction or in the transverse axis. In different direction, joint deformities occur. And last is type four is ankylosis or complete, you know, restriction of the movement of the joint. So the indications of injecting into the joint is a grade one and grade two. That means if there is a swelling in the joint, permanent swelling, and even if swelling is not there, if there are more than three episodes of bleeding during last 6 month period, that is an indication of injecting into the joint or synovectasis. But it's better to avoid in a small children less than 5 years of age because they may not be cooperative. If there's acute bleeding into the joint, because the injection itself can cause another bleeding. If there's unhealthy skin, that may cause infection into the joint. Or if there is any fixed deformities in, you know, joint movements are restricted, then injection itself becomes very painful and patient complains of pain. And patients who are, you know, uncooperative, or there are some people have got psychological problems, and patients with inhibitors, because unless you are availability of FIBA, usually we do not inject the patients with inhibitors. Clinical evaluation, there is a WFH, World Federation of Hemophilia Scoring System, disability evaluation score developed by our occupational therapy department, and we take a consent form from the patient. We do investigations, do the factor assay, inhibitor assay. We do a X-ray follow, there is a Patterson criteria described for hemophilic joints in terms of osteoporosis, epiphyseal enlargement, etc. You do a RBC level bone scan to know about synovial circulation, that what is the blood supply to synovium. Do a ultrasonography to see that what is the thickness of the synovium. And MRI gives us the exact thickness of the synovium, thickening of the joint lining in different directions. The procedure that factor correction is given 20% before injection. Then we aspirate the joint, then give the injection, usually 300 milligram rifampicin into the larger joint like knee and the shoulder, and 150 milligram to small joints like elbow and the ankle. This is followed by a cold therapy for about 20 minutes. Then we give a compressive dressing for about 24 hours. Then we immobilize in this kind of splints, which has been developed by the occupational therapy department of KM hospital, and the rest of the 6 days patient undergoes a rehabilitation. The injection is repeated weekly for 6 weeks. Then follow-up schedule is that clinically we examine the PWH before each injection, then 3 monthly for 1 year, 6 monthly for 2 years. Then we repeat this special investigation, the X-ray, ultrasound, and RBC level bone scan and MRI 3 months after the last injection. So the grading is there, excellent. If there is no bleeding or no pain, good. If there is no bleeding but pain is there, and poor if there is both pain and bleeding persisted. This is one of the PWH with grade 2 synovitis. The left knee has been injected, and this is the result after bleeding, after the injection, the swelling has entirely reduced and there is a full range of movement which is restored. This is the ultrasound examination before injection, after injection, how the thickness of the synovium has reduced. The RBC level bone scan shows that there is a decrease of uptake in the post-injection period, and the MRI shows that the thickness of the synovial membrane has reduced. This is another patient who was taking, these are branding marks of all this heat treatment which he has taken. Now, this is before injection, after injection. And this is the side view, as Professor Judy told you, showed you the triple deformity. And this shows the pre-injection RBC level bone scan, which shows there is a reduced synovial circulation. And the MRI shows there's a reduced thickness of the synovium compared to before injection to after injection. In some people, there is a persistent effect. This is a joint we injected in 1999. This is in 2000 after completing the course of injection. In 2002, we repeated an MRI and we saw that there's a persistent effect. Further, the thickness of the synovium is also reducing there. There is a possibility of acute bleeds. One patient in ankle joint developed an acute bleed while injecting. But of course, that settled down with factor correction and conservative measures. And this was in 2002 in the World Orthopedic Congress, awarded the best paper amongst the 800 abstract, which was published there. Now, what about radioactive synovectomy? Now, initially in 1963, radioactive gold used to be injected into the knee for persistent knee effusions, but there was high leakage rate after the treatment because the particle size was very small. Over the last 50 years, radiosynovectomy has been done in European countries and American countries with erbium-169 in small joint and rhenium and P32, phosphorus-32 in medium joints like wrist, elbow, ankle, and shoulder. And yttrium-99, especially it is injected to a large joint like knee. The advantage of the radioactive material is that it's beta radiation. As you know from our physics knowledge, there are alpha, beta, and gamma. These are three radiations which are emitted from radioactive material. Alpha is a very big particle, so it cannot penetrate the paper also. But beta particles are little smaller particles which can penetrate the paper, but not the aluminum foil. Whereas gamma has got a high penetration activity, it can be protected with the lead only. So these beta particles, which are helpful in hemophilic arthropathy or in synovitis. There's a short range of radiation exposure outside the joint, hence other tissues that do not get affected. And it has got a very low tissue penetration. So up to maximum 10 millimeter penetration is there, which minimizes radiation absorbed dose to the non-target tissue. That means other tissues like muscles and around the skin. The radiation absorbed dose is about 100 gray, which leads to a synovectomy similar to doing a complete surgical synovectomy. So commonly, it has shown a very good result with hemophilic synovitis compared to other synovitis like rheumatoid, psoriasis, osteoarthritis, or villonodular synovitis, or effusions even after joint replacement can be treated with this radioactive material. But a contraindication that pregnancy in a breastfeeding period, if there is a local infection that may lead to infection in the joint, if there is massive hemarthrosis, then radioactive material gets diluted and it doesn't act. If there is ruptured Becker cyst, sometimes there is a cyst in the joint which ruptures, then what happens? The radioactive material may go out of the knee and go into surrounding tissues, can affect the other normal muscles. The response to therapy over 3 months period, it reduces the effusion, inflammatory process, and causes fibrosis of the joint lining, that is synovium. The leakage rate is very low. We immobilize the joint for about 24 to 48 hours. And because the particle size is very, it's comparatively larger, and hence it do not leak to the surrounding structure. If required, it can be repeated at the interval of 3 months, 3 times maximum if required, but usually they do not require, usually one injection serves the purpose. And in hemophilic patients, it reduces the bleeding frequency. Rheumatoids, it takes care of the pain relief. And of course, in pigment and villonodular synovitis, it helps in the radiosynovectomy. But the complications, there is a possibility of skin necrosis because the radioactive material may come out and leak into the surrounding structures. It may cause intra-articular infections if not done in a proper, clean setup. It can cause thrombosis, but it is very rare. It is avoided by heparin prophylaxis in immobilization. But there are very rare chances of radiosynovectomy-induced arthritis, radiation exposure to the whole body, and the genotoxic effect in the peripheral blood, which are not reported after the treatment. Usually after 48 hours immobilization, the leakage rate is less than 2%. These are the comparison chart to show chemical and radionuclide. Chemical procedure like rifampicin or oxytetracycline is an OPD procedure, and anyone can inject. There are no side effects usually, and injection cost is very less. But the disadvantage that you require repeated injection almost 6 times, sometimes 8 times, and 6 times patient needs to be infused with factor, so cost of the factor increases, and there is a possibility of recurrent bleeds. And of course, the availability of rifampicin and oxytetracycline is an issue nowadays in our country. Whereas radionuclide injection, it requires one injection, one factor infusion, but it requires a special setup. You need to have trained personnel, radiation medicine specialist to handle the material. And usually it is avoided in children less than 14 years, lest it may have effect on the growing bone. There may be complications of burn, skin necrosis, even the surgeon or whoever is injecting, the hands may get exposed and can cause necrosis of the skin on the surgeon's hand. And the material itself is expensive also. So this article, which we published in 2020 in World Journal of Hemophilia, actually there was a session in the last conference in Kuala Lumpur conference on synovectomy in hemophilia. And Liz, Sylvia and me were the speakers there. So the conference could not be held, but we published this article. One who are interested, please note down and you can go through this article. Here we have given the parameters of rifampicin, radiosynovectomy, as well as arthroscopic synovectomy and surgical synovectomy. Post-operative stiffness, though it is not common in rifampicin, it is common in the radiosynovectomy. We have also seen in some cases the stiffness is very aggressive because maybe excessive synovial fibrosis occurs with the radiosynovectomy. The morbidity to extra-articular tissue, though rifampicin is minimal, but radioactive synovectomy, there is a possibility of potential radionuclide contamination. Equipment and expertise, it requires, in accordance with the local and international guidelines in KM Hospital, now it is available. And now we are procuring the material from the BRIT or, Baba Atomic Research Center. Now it is much less expensive. One patient can afford to pay around 4,000 to 4,500 rupees for this injection. And the financial perspective, as I told you, the factors may be more expensive for rifampicin injection, but radioactive material, it is more expensive. and a whole lot of contraindications which is there, we can go through this article. So to conclude, synovectasis or the process of injecting into the joint is an useful alternative for achieving near complete chemical synovectomy. Yttrium 90 is commonly used for large joints like knee and the shoulder. Results are excellent in hemophilic synovitis, rheumatoids and osteoarthritis. It requires special setup with trained personnel for radioactive synovitis, synovectomy. Whereas chemical synovectomy with rifampicin and oxytetracycline are useful alternatives for small joints like elbow, ankle and finger joints. I thank you for a patient hearing. I acknowledge the help of Institute of Immunohematology, Dr. Deepika Mohanty, Dr. Ghosh, Dr. Manisha, Department of Hematology, Professor Farah, Professor Chandrakala, Occupational Therapy Department, Professor Kale, Dr. Kirti, and Nuclear Medicine Department, Dr. Shetal, and of course, late Professor Dilwe, and MRI Department, Nanavati Hospital, Dr. Patkar, and Hemophilia Federation of India, Maharashtra Chapter, Dr. Devila Shao. I thank you for a patient hearing. We all dance according to tune of a hemophilia or persons with hemophilic patient. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mohanty. We'll just quickly go to the questions. One of the questions was, is radioactive treatment available in India? Dr. Mohanty has already answered that, Dr. Pooja. The other question is, amongst the chemical and radioactive, which one has been more effective?
I told you about mostly radioactive material is very effective in the larger joints like knee and the shoulder. Whereas chemical synovectomy is better to be injected into elbow, ankle, and small finger joints.
Right. Is there any role of arthrocentesis in acute and chronic hemarthrosis?
Okay. Now, recently we have done a study, you know, Dr. Chandrakala knows about it, that we have been doing arthrocentesis or aspirating the joint in acute hemarthrosis. It has been seen that, you know, if you aspirate the joint, the rehabilitation becomes faster and patients goes back to its normal activity earlier compared to no arthrocentesis. But the arthrocentesis has to be done under factor cover, immediately factor should be available. And you know, it has to be done under a very aseptic setup. Because the only problem is that if you do not follow asepsis, clear asepsis, there are chances of infection in the joint and that will be detrimental for the joint. It will require surgical procedure to drain that joint. So in aseptic procedure under factor cover with one, you know, little thicker needle like 18 or 20 size needle, you just aspirate once, give pressure bandage, then rehabilitation becomes faster and patient recover much faster.
Yeah. So here I'll just add one thing. In the past, when there was not much awareness of hemophilia, we used to get a lot of patients from outside various practitioners, especially orthopedic surgeons, who would see a knee swelling and immediately aspirate, find blood, and then there would be an increased bleeding, and then they would be referred to a hematologist, and then we would diagnose hemophilia. Luckily, those days are much less. And like you said, if it's done properly under aseptic conditions and with proper factor cover, which is even more important, otherwise you'll increase the bleed, then probably maybe there is a role in for it now.
Yeah.
So there's one more question. A patient, after being performed oxytetracycline in the ankle and elbow, was perfect till 3 months. But after that, he started developing pain and cracking sound while walking. An MRI was suggested. The report showed decrease in the synovial membrane and the joint is in fact degrading due to joint friction, causing pain and immobility. So what should be done?
If after 3 months, it has shown that there is a decrease in the thickness of the synovium, but still it is bleeding, that means complete fibrosis has not occurred. That's why it is, you know, further is bleeding. So you can try 2 more doses of oxytetracycline or, you know, rifampicin injection in those joints. And then you can see the effect. So we have injected some of the joints even after 3 months, 6 months or a year after, seeing that, you know, there is a recurrence and we have injected. So repeated injection can be done. The another thing is that radionuclide material joe can be injected, but these are small joints, you know, ankle and elbow joints. There's a small, the joint space is very less. So the chances of, you know, radioactive material extruding out and causing complications and exposure to the surrounding tissues. So usually radioactive material is avoided in this medium-sized joints. It's better to repeat tetracycline and or rifampicin.
Yeah. That's right. And I think one thing we should also stress over here, Dr. Mohanty, that these procedures should be carried out in centers which are used to dealing with hemophilia patients, where right. there is a full teamwork of a hematologist, the physiotherapist, and an orthopedic surgeon who is experienced in these matters. I mean, not anyone and everyone should be, and the lab support, not anyone and everyone should be trying these stunts, you know, in small clinics or something without the necessary expertise, because then you would only end up creating more complications for the patient.
I entirely agree with you. It's always a teamwork, and it should be in a dedicated hemophilia care centers. It should be done, all these procedures should be done.
That's right. With that, I'd like to thank you, Dr. Mohanty.